Matthew chapter 21. I'm going to read verses 28 through 32. Matthew 21, verses 28 through 32. But what think you? A certain man had two sons. And he came to the first and said, Son, go work today in my vineyard. And he answered and said, I will not. But afterward he repented and went.
Amen.
And he came to the second and said, likewise. And he answered, I go, sir. But he went not. Whether of them did the will of his father? They said unto him, the first. Jesus said unto them, verily, verily, I say unto you, that the publicans and the harlots go into the kingdom of God before you. For John came unto you in the way of righteousness, and you believed him not. But the publicans and the harlots believed him. And you, when you had seen it, repented not afterward that you might believe him. We just heard that song written in red. Jesus Christ loved us. And he wrote it in his own blood on the cross. The least you and I can do is be obedient and faithful unto him. Dietrich Bonhoeffer said, when Christ calls a man, he bids him come and die. I bet that won't preach too well in many churches this morning. When Christ calls a man, he bids him come and die. In our text today, we have a parable or a tale of two sons. Both of these sons were given a duty, and they were called to be obedient. One of them, at first, he refused to do the work. But then later down the road, he decides, now I'm going to work and do as my father asked me to do. The second one said, sure, I'll go out and get the work done and do the work, but he never showed up. A lot of church folk like that. The first son in the story here is illustrative of the tax collector, which in the eyes of the people of that day was just dirt. They were just sorry, good-for-nothing scoundrels. So the first son here, he illustrates the tax collectors, the prostitutes, and all general sinners who turn away from God, but then later down the road, they make a decision to do what God wishes them to do, and they repent and then do it. The second son in the story here, he illustrates the Jewish leaders. the Jewish religious people, the Jewish hierarchy of that day, who claimed to be righteous, they claimed to know God, but they had never repented of their sins. They were lost and didn't know it. So in this parable, Jesus is actually confronting the Jewish leaders of his day. You know, preachers can't confront folks today. They get too angry. But Jesus didn't have a problem with confronting folks. Jesus didn't have a problem stirring up controversy. You can't do that day and night.
True.
So Jesus confronts these Jewish leaders. He don't run around there behind their back to confront them. No, he confronts them head on with regards to their character assassination. They are guilty of assassinating the character of Christ. They had attacked John the Baptist. They had attacked Jesus, and they had refused to repent. So Jesus here is giving this stinging rebuke to the chief priests, to the elders, to the leaders for their failure to repent and to place their faith in Christ. Here was God, very God himself, in human flesh, standing before them, and yet they rejected him. Now, in this story, in this parable, what we have is two sons who are demonstrating to us two contrasting responses to the gospel. Two contrasting responses to the truth. You know, if you go out here on the street and you approach 25 people, and you speak the truth to those 25 people, you'll get different responses.
Yeah.
Now, I think we can all agree here that it's best for a person to say, I'm going to do the will of God, and then just go on out there and do it. That's the best case scenario.
Amen.
Beyond that, in a parable here, I think we can say that it turned out better for the son who said, no, I'm not going to do it. I'm not going to be obedient. But then later down the road, he realized his error. He repented, and then he did what he was supposed to do. Much better for that person than the son who said, okay, I'm going out, Father, and do what you've asked me to do. But he never showed up. He never accomplished it. I must say this morning, here, as with in many cases, it was a matter of commitment. It was a matter of commitment. You'll find a lot of people today, not just people of the world, not just lost folk, but you'll find many church folk today who are committed to many different things, and many of them are committed to everything but what they should be committed to, And that is the work of Christ. That is perhaps one of the great problems that is facing particularly the church in our nation today. It's hard to get a commitment. It's difficult to get people to make a commitment. And then once people make a commitment, it's difficult to get them to follow through on it. People are like spasmatic, they're impulsive. Over the years, I've seen it as a pastor. We've seen it over the years. People will come into the church and they're rip, roaring, snorting, they're raring to go. They're on fire for God. They do anything. And then slowly you begin to see the fire begin to wilter. Next thing you know, they're missing a service here. And they're missing a service there. And it's a slow, progressive thing. And as they fade away, the devil's just waiting for that door to crack. And when it does, he jumps in and they're finished.
Amen.
True.
And so this is one of the great problems facing the current church in America. People are no longer willing to make a commitment to Jesus Christ. Listen, when you make a commitment to Christ, you make a commitment to the body of Christ, whom Jesus referred to as the church. How can we say that we are committed to Christ when we don't want to be a part of the body of Christ?
Amen.
The discovery of faithful people, those who make a commitment to Christ and those who will faithfully serve Him in the church. Most pastors will tell you they're hard to find today, folks. Or you'll find many who will say that they will, but you'll find very few who will make a genuine commitment and then follow through on it. To do God's will. You say, what is God's will for my life, preacher? To do God's will is to accept the gospel of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
To receive Jesus Christ as Messiah, Savior, and Lord.
Amen.
Right.
We can't have one without the other. There are too many folks today who have their foot halfway in the door. Christ demands all of us.
Amen.
Christ demands from us a life of faithfulness and obedience.
Hallelujah.
It's true.
And so there's your introduction. I want you to leave here understanding this. The Lord desires obedient deeds more than words. God desires deeds more than words. Folk can say anything. Saying it and doing it are two different things, folks.
That's true.
And so the first thing I want to get across to you is this. And we all know it. Actions speak much louder
than words.
Than words.
Amen.
Actions speak much louder than words. Now, our story this morning, this parable that Jesus gives us, is applicable to the multitudes. He's addressing the Jewish leaders primarily, yet there is a principle here that we can apply to the multitudes. Do you know how many people are on church rolls across this country as members this morning who are not in church? I dare say that there are many, many more people who have a little card in the cabinet in the office who are members of such and such church, but they haven't been to church in years. If they showed up, most churches wouldn't have room for them. And so there are a lot of people who join the church. There are a lot of people who are religious folk. There are a lot of people who believe they are Christians when in reality they're not. Jesus said this. In that day, many, he didn't say a few. Jesus said, in that day, many will come to me and say, Lord, Lord, have we not done many wonderful things in your name? And he will say, depart from me, you workers of iniquity, I never knew you. Amen. Those are frightening words, folks. There are churches across this country today. Some of them are filled to capacity, who have perfected church ritual like a peacock who knows how to strut its feathers around. And they will give mental assent to all of the great important doctrines of the Bible. But they're not genuine unless they have had a true, genuine, supernatural transformation of their spirit taking place within that is performed by the Spirit of God. Through the Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Paul said it. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Did you get that? A new creature. I dare say, if you went out and bought a new automobile today, and you were driving an old clunker that was 25 years old, that was all scratched up and dented up, puttered down the road, I bet you you'd take a lot better care of that new car you did that old. Why? Because it's new. Bible says if we've been born again, we are new creatures. You buy a new car, you expect it to look new, don't you? Matter of fact, you buy a new car, if you like me, you don't expect to see a ding, a dent, a scratch anywhere. But I guarantee you, if you look good, you'll find one somewhere.
Amen.
Because there's only one thing that's perfect, and that's God.
Amen.
The publican. The riffraffs of society, the prostitutes, you see, they recognized their sinfulness. You don't have to tell this homeless guy down here on the street who's doing drugs every night, drinking himself into a coma for the last 25 years. You don't have to tell him he has a problem. I guarantee you, he knows he has a problem. Yeah.
Right.
But you try to tell this person who's been in the church for 40 years, who's learned how to play the rituals, who's learned how to play the part, who wears the mask very good, who is full of self-righteousness, you try to tell them they have a problem, and you're going to find out you've got a problem on your hands. Because they'll show themselves. And so the publicans, the harlots, the prostitutes, the down and out, the poor, they recognize their own sinfulness, and many times the result of that was they came to Christ and accepted him for who he was. You see, here's a problem we have in the church today, folks. You can't even tell folk they have a problem. And if you can't tell folk they have a problem, then how much sense does it make to tell them that you have a solution to their problem? We can't tell folk they have a problem today. If we do, we're judging. We're mean-spirited. We're unloving. We're unkind. We're bigoted. But the reality of it is, until a person comes to the reality and understands and recognizes and acknowledges that he has a problem called sin, he'll never be saved from it. That's one of the reasons that so few in churches are being genuinely saved today, because we don't have preachers in pulpits who are willing and bold enough to take a stand and dare to offend folk and tell them they have a sin problem and they need salvation. So the tax collectors and the prostitutes, they came late, but they came.
Amen.
They came late, but they came. They repented, and guess what Christ did? He opened his arms wide open to them. The religious rulers, on the other hand, the self-righteous, on the other hand, those who thought that they had God packaged in their pretty little box with the bow on it, they would have nothing to do with it. Jesus said they were all cleaned up on the outside. They had adorned themselves on the outside, but the problem was there had been no transformation that had taken place on the inside. They were just actors. That's why I don't watch this mess. I don't even know what they call it. Grammys, Tonys, Toby. I don't know what they're called. Oscars, whatever they are. I don't even watch them. Why? You're dealing with a bunch of actors, folks. They're actors on stage and off stage. They don't even know who they are. They've been acting another life for so long. That was the Jewish leaders of Jesus' day. They were play actors, and Jesus called them hypocrites. That's what a play, that's what a play actor, that's how you define a hypocrite, is an actor. Listen, Jesus is not a decorator, folks. Jesus has no desire to decorate us all up. No. God's desire is to truly transform our inner being. get pretty on the inside first.
Amen.
And then that prettiness on the inside will eventually begin to show on the outside. So actions speak much louder than words. The Lord desires obedient deeds more than he does worthless words. The second thing we see in this story today is this. The spiritual playing field is level for us all. The spiritual playing field is level for all. Notice in this parable that the father, he gives both sons the same instructions. I get tickled sometimes. I watch these cop shows. And invariably, you watch these cop shows, they're going to pull over somebody that's had too much to drink. And they'll get out of the car. And the officer will ask him, "How much you had to drink tonight, sir?"
Two beers.
Two beers a couple hours ago. And he starts, about all he can do. He's a weaving and a stuttering and a slurring. And then the cop will start to give him that test, you know, how to walk that straight line. And he's wobbling all over. They are given specific instructions. And I've seen them on cops after the cop has given the instructions three or four times. They still ask him, "Now, what was it you wanted me to do?" They don't get it. Why? Because they're intoxicated. Their mind is incapable of getting it. And so the father here in this parable gives his son the same instructions. Now, of course, the father here is representative of God. He's representative of God the Father. And the playing field of this world is not always level, folks. Most of you in here have lived in this world long enough to know that the playing field out there is not level. It's anything but level.
That's right.
But in God's sphere of salvation, the spiritual field is level. But you see, the God of this world is always busy, folks. I say God, I mean the God with the little g, not the big g. The God of this present world. The God of this present system. You know what he's busy doing? He's busy corrupting and manipulating. And let's just give him credit when credit's due. He's good at it. Both of these sons were given the very same instruction. Do you know that each one of us sitting in here this morning, and every other Christian, and every lost person out there, God has given all of us the very same instruction? Right here. All you have to do is read it. So the playing field is level for all of us. God's given us all the same instruction. This is the instruction manual, folks. It's the only one available. And it gives us everything that we need when we determine and make a decision that we are going to follow after and do the will of God.
Amen.
God's word is God's will. That's very easy to remember right there. God's word is God's will for everyone. And he's made the instructions rather simple. Peter did say that Paul wrote some things that were difficult to understand, but for the most part, God's instructions are very, very simple for those who are willing to follow them. There's no prejudice. There's no discrimination. There's no favoritism on the part of God. None whatsoever. Now, it's important for us to notice something about these two sons. And that is, to some extent, both of them failed. What does that tell us? None of us are perfect.
Amen.
We all fall short. We all come up short, folks. But as I was preparing this message, I was reminded of what Dina's nephew said right here in this pulpit at his grandfather's memorial service. And that was this. It's not how you begin the race, it's how you finish.
Amen.
Not how you begin. It's how you finish.
Amen.
Now, both of these sons ended up doing the exact opposite of what they said they were going to do. They did exactly the opposite. I suspect at some time or another in our lives, all of us have been guilty of that.
Amen.
But we need to understand this very important element. The emphasis here is not on the intent of these two sons. The emphasis is not on what they intended to do, but what they did. Actions speak louder than words. So what did they eventually do? What they did was an outcome that was based upon the action that they took, not the words that they spoke. Paul said over in Galatians, be not deceived. Whatsoever a man sows, that shall he reap. That's the law of God, folks. So reality is, actions are more significant than words. Actions are more significant than words. Again, as a pastor of some 20 years, I've had people make all kind of commitments. You wouldn't believe some of the commitments that people have come to me and made. Some of them didn't last a week. I've seen them come and go, never fulfilling any of the promises that they made, and their actions defied their words. Now, spiritually speaking, every one of us depart from our mother's womb in the same spiritual condition. Sick, diseased, eventually leads us to commit sins. We sin because we are born sinners. And God makes no distinction of those who remain in their sin. He defines them as spiritually dead. How many of you in here have been to more than one funeral? You ever seen one man that was more dead than the other?
No.
They're both dead. Doesn't matter what either one of them did in their life, physically speaking, they're both dead. They can't talk, they can't hear, they can't move. That body is dead. Man is born into this world spiritually dead. All spiritually dead on the same spiritual level. Dead is dead. All men, because of that, need to be spiritually resurrected from the dead.
Amen.
That's why Jesus said, you must be born again. And it's a procedure, get this, that can only be performed by the great physician himself.
Amen.
The creator of you and I, the creator of this universe and all that it contains. Only he can raise the dead. So the spiritual playing field is level for us all. I got to quickly finish up here. Last point is, we believe God and obey him or we don't. One or the other. Mostly it was the riffraff of society who believed Jesus. It was the lowlife, the tax collectors, the prostitutes, they came. They came to John the Baptist. They came to Jesus. I'm reminded of the Apostle Paul this morning. Paul was a Pharisee. He was Saul, and he was a Pharisee on the road to Damascus when God knocked him down on the ground.
Struck him down.
And what did Paul reply? Lord, what would you have me do?
Amen. He knew who knocked him down.
That needs to be the question for all of us. Lord, what would you have me do? And then do it.
Amen.
Somebody said, I saw the other day, somebody said, what's the best Bible you can read? The best Bible you can read is the one that you will read. How about that?
Amen.
If you don't read it, it won't do you much good.
That's no good to you. Right.
The Lord wants us to believe him. And when we believe God, I'm going to say to you, when we truly believe God, then we'll obey him.
Amen.
You know why so many parents have trouble with their children today? Because their children don't believe that their parents mean what they say.
It's like the parents.
Because actions speak louder than words.
They curse like the parents, they do what the parents do. Exactly.
God has called every man everywhere to repent. That's God's instruction to all men. Now a desire should be faithfulness to our Redeemer. The one who loved us even while we were yet sinners. And so let me close this morning asking you, where do you stand with God this morning? Where do you stand? Did you once, maybe years ago, make a commitment but you failed? to follow through? Was it one time in your life you rebelled and then you returned to the Lord? Or maybe you're still a sinner living in sin and need to be saved. You know, I was one who came to the Lord when I was 10 years old. But I didn't follow through. As a teenager, I veered off course, went the wrong way, didn't follow the instructions. For 10 years, I didn't follow the instructions. Everywhere I went, folks, I run into a trunk. The answer was nowhere else to be found. Couldn't find it in a bottle. Couldn't find it in a bar. Couldn't find it at the horse track. Couldn't find it at the dog track. Couldn't find it at the blackjack table. Couldn't find it at the poker table. Couldn't even find it at the Walmart, Mom. But one day, like the prodigal, I came to my senses.
There's the time they said Christ too.
And I said, yes, Lord.
Amen.
What would you have me to do?
Amen.
Exactly.
We believe God and obey Him, or we don't. The Lord desires obedient deeds more than words. D.L. Moody said this, our faith must be tested. God builds no ships, but what He sends to sea. There's a third son in the story this morning that's untold. That's Jesus. But you see, you can go back as far as time goes, as far back as eternity goes. And God the Father, and God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit met together in council. And the Father said to the Son, I want you to go, planet Earth. I want you to become one of them. I want you to walk in their shoes. And I want you to write your love for them in red with the shedding of your blood on the cross. And Jesus said, I'll do it, Father. I'll do it. And He was born of a virgin. And He walked this earth some 33 years before they crucified Him. He was the perfect, obedient Son. He was obedient unto the Father unto death. That's the perfect Son. All of us fall short, folks. But what God has given us is the offer to receive His perfection, not having to stand in our own perfection. You're here this morning, you need prayer for whatever reason it might be. I don't care what it is. You need to get back right with God. You need to make things right with God. You come this morning, let me pray with you and pray for you as we sing this hymn.